and I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the man who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today, 'cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA.
Okay, Davis, staff, students, and guests, will you please rise and remove your hats as Mrs. Walden sings our national anthem.
Come on, up, 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 up. Let me see where you're at. responsible for making my life miserable for the last week. My wife is an Eisenhower graduate. Now, we might know how that conversation went. Good job, gentlemen. Have a seat. I gotta identify my group. How many people in here play Xbox? You will then know that Call of Duty and Fallout just came out, and this is interrupting my gameplay time. So, now, I have in my hand this speech, and I'm told that I'm the only thing between you and the day off tomorrow. Now, this is about 75 minutes. We don't need that. So, what I'd like to do, though, is give you a little capsule of what I think it is to be a veteran and tell you a tiny bit about my career. But first of all, real quick, let me give you my credentials. I am from Toppenish. You know, and in life, you have to write a resume. So I was writing my resume out, and I was telling this gentleman I wanted this job, and I put down, I said, you know, we used to play this game out in Toppenish in the pastures. We would run out and pick up cow pies, and then we'd run over to the barn, and we would throw them against the wall. Now, if you weren't very good at it, you'd pick up these crusty ones, you'd try to throw them, and they'd just kind of break up in the wind, you know, and they were dusty. Or you'd get the slimy ones, you'd go to throw it, fly right back in your face. Now me, on the other hand, I could pick up a good cow pie, I could throw it against that wall, and it would go and slide down the wall. Now the moral of that story is I know how to throw BS, and I'm going to do a little right now. All right. In 1969, I was a senior. How many seniors in here stand up? Come on. I want you to stay standing for a minute. Now in 1969, if you were a girl, sit down. Girl, sit down. Guys, I don't know what you have planned, but in 1969, if you were a boy and you were a senior, you were going to Vietnam! Right on. You're crazy. So sit down. Now, I got drafted in 1969, sold my car, did a bunch of things, and said, I'm going to Vietnam. Got to the physical, and the doctor says, you ain't going to Vietnam. You have a defective elbow, and we don't need you in the military. Oh, okay, that's cool, because, you know, in the 60s, we were chasing free love, and I was buying all I could get. I've been paying for it for about 45 years now. My lovely wife is over there somewhere. She told me that stuff was free. It wasn't. Now, 1974, I was living with my in-laws. I just got fired and evicted from my house. Couldn't hold a job, didn't know what the heck to do with my life, so I went to the Air Force recruiter. I said, I fixed my arm, could I come into the military? Okay, what do you want to be? And I said, I don't know, but I got John Wayne running through my veins, and I'm going to be a war hero. Yeah, I'm going to be cool. I almost ended up setting the world record for peeling the most potatoes for being a dumbass in the military. I got that done pretty good when I was in basic training. Then I went on to be what's known as a survival instructor, and I taught parachute landing falls for about 6 years. That's kind of funny because, you see, I've never jumped out of an airplane. You do not have to jump out of an airplane to teach how to land when you fall down on the ground. We got a little harness. Hangs up and you can fall right out of the ground. Well, I had 14 knee surgeries as a result of that 6 years, and now I have both my knees replaced and I'll have both my hips replaced. That's why I'm a disabled veteran. I didn't get no neat story where I was driving them G3 guys and blew me up and here I am a war hero. But I am a hero because we ended the Cold War during my tenure. You may not have realized that. My generation, from 1974 to 1994, and by the way, for those of you that really care about that stuff, I have exactly 7 minutes and 21 seconds of combat in 20 years. And that's when I actually knew somebody really wanted to hurt me really bad, and I was scared as hell. That's what combat is. But during that time frame, I ended, helped end the Cold War. We're very proud of that, those of us in that particular tenure. I want you to leave understanding that, in my opinion, there are four kinds of veterans out there, four categories, and you need to be aware of them. There's a fifth one, but unfortunately they're dying off rapidly. World War II and World War I veterans, if you get the chance to meet one, do me a favor. Don't walk up and thank him for his service. Walk up, put your arms around him and say, man, you rock. Because those dudes did some things that we just wouldn't even think about doing. The next group are the Korean and the Vietnam veterans, and I'll be telling you quite frankly that a lot of Vietnam veterans are really not real happy with their role in life. You see, they went off to a war, and when they came back, I personally witnessed this. They would come home and they'd get off the bus and they'd walk out. People would spit on them and call them baby killers. I had a real good friend. They did that too. They didn't understand he'd spent the last 6 months crawling through a jungle hoping to hell he could get home to see his family. All they knew was he was doing something they didn't like. The next group are the peacetime veterans. That's what I call myself. Then you have the Desert Storm, Desert Shield, Afghanistan, Iraq, Iran, and whatever the hell else we're doing today. Those are the veterans of today. But there's a whole new one. Ladies, I want you to stand up now. All girls in this place, stand up. Come on, stand up. Oh, you know, we ain't going home if you don't follow instructions. All right, so see, gentlemen, look around. All right, sit down, sit down. Okay, you gotta be real quiet for this next part. Shh. I have five daughters. You know, I always said, 20 years in the military, the same woman for 45 years and five daughters, you can't hurt me anymore. But anyway, women finally got their way. They said, we want to be combat soldiers. And guess what? Today they are. In my time, we did not have female combat veterans. Today we do. And they're every bit as tough, every bit as mean, and shoot every bit as good as any other person that picks up a weapon. And I'm very proud that that has happened. So when you go out, I would ask you this question. I want you to ask yourself right now. A lot of young people come up to me and they say, hey, thank you for your service. What the hell are you thanking me for? I've always been curious what it is you think you're thanking me for. Well, let me see. I've been around the world. I've done a lot of different things. Raised my family in the military. And I'm retired. I love taxpayers. Taxpayers are just doing real good for me right now, and I'm really liking it. I like to travel, and I like to do a lot of things, and taxpayers, y'all are paying for it, and I love you. Now, when you walk up and thank somebody for the service, this is what I want you to think about, because you see, I'm kind of unique. I have been in the military for 120 years. Do you believe that? No? I have a wife. And I have five daughters. During my 20-year tenure, they were in the military with me. Now, the last I counted, 6 times 20, even in your modern math, is 120. You see, the military is a family involvement. Do I have cheerleaders in here? Where are the cheerleaders at? Well, for you cheerleaders, I want you to imagine, one day my daughter came home and she said, Dad, Dad, guess what? I'm going to be captain of the cheerleaders next year. And I said, oh, that's fantastic, Tara, but guess what? We're going to Turkey. I don't think that's going to work out real good. I was about as popular as a rerun Leave It to Beaver shows. Well, wherever I went, my family went too. So I want to leave you with two last thoughts, and then we're going to wrap this thing up. Actual events that I think describe my career more than any other. While we were in Turkey, my wife and daughters had an occasion to work at a place called the Youth Center. There was a young tech sergeant, his name was Victor Margot. He worked for me for those 2 years, and he taught them judo. He and his wife were stationed there, and my daughters got to know them pretty well by the Youth Center, and right after we left, you know, every day in the morning after Desert Storm started, I would make my kids go out to the car, and they'd walk around, and I said, I want you to find wires on the ground in case somebody's trying to blow your dad up. Oh, Dad. They thought it was ridiculous that I would make them go out and do this. 2 weeks after we left country, I got a telegram, one of them things they don't do anymore, and it said that Tech Sergeant Victor Marvick and his wife had gone out to their car to go to work at 9 o'clock in the morning. Sergeant Marvick opened the door, sat down on the seat, turned on the ignition, and was blown through the roof of his car. His wife was blown approximately 70 yards from the car, had multiple fractures and abrasions. She survived. Victor was killed. Victor was killed simply because he believed in that thing that's hanging from the center of your wall. You may have noticed that I saluted that flag rather than take my hat off or put my hand away. So let's get one thing straight right now. I am not politically correct. I believe that political correctness has killed common sense in this country. That's the only political statement you're going to get out of me. I am a John Wayne kind of guy. I open the door for ladies. I believe the good guy should always win. And I will knock the hell out of you if you try to take something that's mine. So see, that's what a veteran is to me. There are people in this country who have lost sight of that. What you need to understand is there is a whole world of people out there who have but one goal in mind, and that is to kick your young butts out of this country because they don't think you deserve it. They don't think the American way of life is going to work. In fact, they want to do away with the American way of life, and I will tell you that the only reason that I can be here today and the only reason that that flag is flying is from all of your teachers, all of your classmates, your family, whoever that makes the decision or has chosen to serve in the United States military. And they are veterans. And every single day that you hop in your little car, go down, grab your Starbucks, do whatever it is that you do, go home like I do and play 5 hours of Xbox at night. I don't care what it is you do, I want you to understand that you're doing that because somebody like myself and many of your teachers who I know are veterans, we decided to put a uniform on, go across the ocean and say, if you want to mess with our people, you got to get through us first and we're going to kick your ass straight back to hell. That's just the way it is. Now, I apologize for those unnecessary words, but that truly is what American spirit's all about. We do not run. We fight. We fight because we believe that the American way of life is important and the American way of life exists on the backs of people that have worn the uniform. And you should never lose sight of that. So the next time that you walk up to a man and you say, or a woman, and you say, sir or ma'am, thank you for your service, in the back of your mind, I want you to say amen and keep right on fighting. Is there anybody in here right now that's in the delayed enlistment program? Would you come down here real quick? Please. Come on. What branch of service are you going in? Marines? I thought I was going to like you, but that's... You too? What branch?
Even worse.
Army. Well, I have something for you. Take that. All right? And I have something for you. Got another one? Oh, you want something? Air Force Academy. All right, you get Call of Duty. I'm sorry. You get... All right. I want you to hang on to those, and I want all of you to remember, and I want you to remember this. Without people like you and without the others that might make that decision, our country doesn't exist. That's called a challenge coin. I want you to hang on to that coin until someday you meet somebody that's going to take up the mantle for you, and I want you to give it to them. When you've completed your service, and make sure that that person's worthy. I already know that you are because you've been willing to step forward. Give them a hand. Okay, one last war story and we're out of here. I think I'm doing, oh yeah, I'm right on time. You're going to get out maybe a couple minutes early. People often ask me, was I ever afraid in my military career? And they say, do you ever feel like your life was in jeopardy? And I tell them, I never really thought that until June 20th, 1994. On June 20th, 1994, I was in an office about the size of your principal's office, and I had just finished getting my blood work done for my retirement physical at Fairchild Air Force Base. Now, I was a master sergeant, and I had what's called a two-line name tag. That meant that I was the chief of training for Fairchild Air Force Base, and that made me extra special. So a young staff sergeant came up to me, and he said, Sergeant Shirley, go to lunch. I don't want you to wait around here killing time. You're getting ready to retire. And I told that young staff sergeant, I don't need to do that. I don't want to get you in trouble. No, you go to lunch. I left his office and I went out to get in my car and I observed a yellow cab, which I really didn't pay a dang bit of attention to. And a young feller got out of that cab. 10 minutes later, he killed that staff sergeant that told me to go to lunch. In fact, he killed 5 people on Fairchild Air Force Base that day and shot 14 others. That was the day that a young man was disgruntled. He came onto Fairchild Air Force Base, and he shot and killed several people. Now, can you imagine the epitaph? Here I am, 20 years in the military, and Master Sergeant Shirley gets killed taking his retirement physical at Fairchild Air Force Base. But there is a moral to that story that I want you to bear in mind, too. Never think that you're always 100% safe in life. Unfortunately, today we have lots of mass shootings and lots of different things like that that take place. People seem to have lost their common sense. I often believe that life is a journey, ladies and gentlemen. It's a journey that's best traveled with someone you love, with family, and an understanding that it's not the destination that counts, it's how you get there that's important. I admire each and every one of you. You have the future of a nation that I dedicated 20 years of my life to in your hands. You will go out and be lawyers and doctors and bartenders and drunks, and I don't know what you're going to be. You're going to be whatever it is that you want to be, and that's what counts. As for myself, I am proud to say that I spent 20 years of my life making sure you'd have that opportunity. Thank you for letting me speak to you today.
God bless the U.S.